Hey everyone, Ed McCurdy, MCDJ, DJ Ed. Today's the day. I'm going to do my first remote recording. I'm going to Monroe Falls. I'm going to digitally record surround sound and some video. And earlier, I had some ideas of what it was I was going to talk about when I get there, but of course, I just now got in the vehicle and it's raining. But it's supposed to be not raining, so we'll see what it's like when I get there. I'm on my way. It's 42 degrees, which is totally unusual for this time of year. It should be snowing and whatnot. We're going to find out what it's like at Monroe Falls today. Just leaving Orrington. I'll be there in about 20 minutes and I'll be back. Enjoy. Cool thing is, it's stopped raining. We're almost halfway there. Good sign. We're on Monroe Road. Pretty good when you live in a big enough town that they name a road after it. I lived in Monroe for 17 years. Drove this ride many times. New houses and things going up here that I haven't seen. I haven't been out this way in a while. Brings back a lot. Big old Victorian mansion, had 10 bedrooms, 2 kitchens, 2 living rooms, 3 floors, closets in every room, even back then. And the smallest bedroom was like 12 by 14, it was 5,500 square foot. Built in 1898, I think. Side. Full it is. icy. I knew this might be the last opportunity to get out here. There was snow.
Monroe Falls. It's raining. I got the camera set up with my audio surround sound recorder. Trying to keep it dry. Get a little bit of video
and audio. These are the days I choose to do these things. But it is Maine. And I should know that. There. So I was going to tell stories while I was out here. But I can't leave my camera. And I don't want to confuse the sound of nature with me, so this is what we get. I may come back in a minute. I'm just going to enjoy. Hey, everybody. We're still here at Monroe Falls. And we walked down and got sound and video of just the falls. But I'm going to come down and hang out with you guys and tell you a little story from my past. It's funny because this place reminds me of things from the past. We used to come down here with the kids and swim. It's a pretty neat place. Whenever there's not quite so much water rushing over, it has some nice little pools. And it's nice and icy cold when it's 90 degrees out in the summertime. It's a great little place to swim. Normally in December, you wouldn't be hiking down here because it would be pretty icy. Unless you had spikes on your shoes. As you'll see in some of the video when I walked in and walked out. I'm actually going to write some music to this little trip as well. That will kind of have something to do with this little story I'm about to tell you. And actually the theme is just like what it is today. It's kind of about being alone. Actually it is about being alone. I'm out here now alone and I wasn't sure that I'd be alone down here. Notice how much louder it gets. See if I can get you an angle. When you come down this side of the fall, it's so much louder. So I might stay up above to tell my story. See if I can get out there. Funny thing is normally you'd come on a not rainy day, and I actually thought I had made it where it wasn't. But you can never tell about one forecaster to another. That's a pretty good spot. Yeah. Can I switch these? Alright. So I'm sitting at the top part of the falls. Just under the bridge. It's a little bit quieter here. There's a little bit of drizzle still happening. Let's see if I can flip this around. So this is where I'm sitting, along this stone wall right here. The top of the falls is right there. When you go down over the top of that, it's so loud you wouldn't be able to hear me talk. Nice day here, even though it's a little chilly.
it's still 40 degrees, which is unheard of for December 28th, 2020. Great year.
Had a lot of time to think this year.
I've been wanting to write some music to places just like this. Relaxing music. That may be used to either let you meditate about things that you need to, or maybe even just check out of things that you need to. Maine's a beautiful place for either. My story, as I said, for today, it's about being alone. And you know what's funny? That could mean so many things. Sometimes after too many crowds, too much partying, too much pressure, too many things from work, being alone is exactly what you want. This isn't such a bad place to come and do that. But then, there's times when you're alone and you don't really want to be alone, and you think you're alone, when maybe you aren't. But nobody cares. Nobody notices. Makes you wonder what goes on inside other people's heads when they don't notice you. About 30 years ago, I came up with an answer on one of the reasons why I feel alone sometimes. That kind of alone where you wonder where everybody went. And just because I did figure that out, I realized that I really wasn't alone. Now I've learned that having time to myself is kind of a cool thing. And it's funny how we call that being alone, time to yourself. But when you choose it because you just need some peace and quiet, or in this case, peace and noisy. It's a peaceful noise here. Just water constantly running down this stream. Not sure exactly where it came from. Not sure exactly where it's going to. Sometimes when you're alone, you're just like a little boat floating down the stream. And if you're not careful, you can think that you're about to head over a waterfall and that it's over. That may or may not be the case.
Like, you can't let it stop you. So my story starts back, it was somewhere around 1990. I was 37 years old back then. And I was in this group. It were counselors, and it was a movement nationwide, I think. And it was called co-counseling, where regular individuals sat down together with commitments of confidentiality, and one would spend an hour talking about what was going on for them, and then they'd switch to the second hour, and the other person would talk about what was going on for them. It wasn't professionals. It wasn't people who'd been trained in any other way other than by being listened to in their own way, that we learned to listen to each other. It was a kind of a neat, I have to say, cult, because it kind of was. And there's stories for other days about that part of it. But some of it was pretty profound. One day, I was feeling really alone. And I had my 2-hour session scheduled. And my counselor, just another human being like myself, asked me how it was going. You'd do that as a counselor. You'd ask just short, quick, pertinent questions and then listen. Sometimes you wouldn't even ask any questions. Sometimes you just hold somebody and let them cry and not even ever find out why or even wonder. You just let them cry. It was pretty powerful. But this day, we sat, and I was sad, and I was alone. I was lonely. And my counselor held me, and I cried a little. And when I was breathing a little easier, my counselor said, "When was the first time you remember being alone?" That is one of the best questions anyone has ever asked me. So I sat and I thought for a minute, maybe for 5 or 10. And all of a sudden it hit me. The first time I remembered at that moment being alone was when I was 6 months old. I know, 6 months. And it was just as plain as if I was sitting there, the memory. I was sitting in a dining room on the floor. It was kind of dark all around. I had some toys laying on the floor around me, and I was alone. And I kind of cried, and I wondered why would I be remembering that I was alone when I was 6 months old. I didn't know at that moment why. But I felt it. And after a little emotional moment, crying. I just sat there in that little dark room with my toys around by myself. And it wasn't so bad. It wasn't even so sad, but it was kind of profound. I was trying to figure out how the heck I remembered it 36 years later, just being in the moment of being alone. So we were pushing on close to the end of my hour and just sitting there. I did not speak a lot. And all of a sudden it hit me that when I was 6 months old, my 4-year-old sister was diagnosed with leukemia. And it was maybe 7-8 months later, she died. And all of a sudden, it hit me what could have possibly been going on in the minds of my parents. Back in 1954 and 55, leukemia was incurable. There wasn't even any treatment. They just sent you home and wished you well. And I do not have any details to this day about how that was for my parents. They never talked about it. I always wondered. But once I felt that moment where I realized that was the first time I was alone, I started to begin to put things together about a lot of things in my life. Losing a child at 4 years old, beautiful, sweet, blonde, Margie, by the way, is her name, Margie. I didn't even know her birth date. I didn't know her death date. I didn't know anything. They didn't talk about it. But they didn't let it stop them completely. They let them stop them thinking about that, but they never let it stop them. They continued on. They raised us. And when I remember my first time being alone, that's the most profound, and that's probably one of the only times I was just alone. We used to go water skiing. We did a lot of fun things in my life. But it told me a lot of stories about why a lot of things happened from then on. I had another sister who was a year and a half older than me, and she was two and a half when Margie died. And I don't know what her memories of her are either. But the one thing I can look now back on, almost 67 years later, is I'm not alone. And not even close to it. And one thing I learned from that is when you lose someone, you can't be quiet about it. I have so much to learn about my sister, and at this moment, there's not too many places to go. Both of my folks have since died. My sister lives in California. We don't talk about things like that much. Maybe we will someday, but I was doing ancestry.com. I've been spending some time on it the last couple of years, and all of a sudden, one day, came a notification I had put my sister, Margie McCurdy. She was born 1951, died in 1955, and there was a green leaf that came up as a hint. And so I clicked on it, and there was a picture of her gravestone. I didn't even know she had a gravestone. And there it was. Pretty profound. I've never been there. Someday I have to make a trip to California to go see it. But at least now I have a picture. I brought it up to my sister and she goes, yeah, I knew it was there. I've been there a couple times. And that's it. So thankfully, once I figured out why I might feel alone once in a while, I've been also able to realize that I'm never alone. So hopefully, in days coming, I'll tell you more stories about what makes Ed McCurdy, out here in nature. Because sharing this profound information about ourselves is what makes us not alone. Everyone has stories that are sad from the past that we just don't talk about. And we should. So if you ever have stories you'd like to talk about, I'm happy to do that. We've got a lot to share on this planet, and it's way more than going to our jobs every day and buying things, playing video games, and Facebooking. Way more. So I've gone up and down this stream this whole time I was talking. And it's pretty neat to think that not 1 ounce of the water has been the same this whole time. I don't know how many gallons go by here every minute. But they go over the rocks a little different each time. The waves whip around. Every one of those ounces of water is just like us. Moving along. Different. Changing. Tomorrow, there'll be less water probably coming down because this rain will be gone. And the snow that melted will be gone, and soon there's going to be ice here. And there'll be just a little trickle. I will try to come back this winter somehow and see what it looks like. This ever-changing planet we live on. I hope you're having a great day. I am. Be safe. I'll see you next time.